to thank our speakers for really very interesting presentations, but I believe that the most interesting part of the panel is still ahead of us, and this your questions, your comments, and speakers' answers. So I guess we can start. Any questions or any comments, please? I'm sorry, I completely forgot. We taped this and we ask everyone who will be commenting or asking questions, please ask Kevin for mic and he'll bring the mic to you.
Mm-hmm. The letter from Stalin to Lazar Kaganovich, you have to straighten out the situation or we lose Ukraine. Beyond the obvious, what did Stalin mean by straightening out the situation, and what did he mean by losing Ukraine? If he meant killing all the Ukrainians, then he just wanted the geographical territory. Presumably he didn't mean that. What did he mean exactly, as far as people?
Okay, thank you. Maybe I'll ask for one couple questions more, and then our speakers will answer. So next, I understand.
That question.
Yeah, I probably will collect two or three questions.
Okay,
together,
well, being the devil's advocate for archives, I do have a few questions that occur to me, but I also have, well, I want to compliment the speakers for a very interesting presentation, and particularly the production of the Derzhkom Archive of the State Archives of Ukraine. I think this is a marvelous work that has been going on there. But I have, there are a couple of things that occur to me, and I don't want to go with all of them right now because it would take too long. But one other possible source that I think might be worth exploring, that is if no one has, and it may be they have because I haven't looked into this, is the impact of the German invasion of 1941 on the source base. Because we know, and from my own work on the wartime invasion for another subject, not the famine, but for on cultural affairs, that we know that there was a massive intentional destruction by Soviet authorities in 1941. And I would imagine that sources relating to the famine, including the Zaks records, which were mentioned as one of the important complexes of sources that need to be studied, this was one of the things that they were being that the Soviets, we have proof from German documents of this destruction, and I think I've written about this elsewhere, about the tremendous destruction in 41 on the local level in Ukraine. That's one side of the story, but the flip side of the story, it's quite understandable that they didn't want the Germans to get them, but the Germans did get some of these documents, and they took away a lot of the Zaks archives from Ukraine, from places in Ukraine that they had reached. And I'm just wondering if someone has looked into what Zaks archives were destroyed intentionally in 41, and what the Germans got, and whether when they came back, whether there was further filtration, because a lot of the things came back to Moscow first. Before they went were given back to Ukraine, such as the Dnipropetrovsk Party Archive, a good part of that the Germans did get, and they found the Germans found the Soviet orders for the destruction of the Dnipropetrovsk archive. I use that as an example with our chair today. And I've published excerpts from that document. But I think it may be an important factor. But the flip side of this story is what the Germans took and what they did with it. And I haven't looked into this myself. I've been only looking into the taking and what happened to the archives, not what they so much what they did with it. But I know that in the case of the Smolensk archive, the party archive that they got from Smolensk, it went to Vilnius, and there was a group of Nazi scholars working in Vilnius on collectivization, and because they wanted to use these type of archival materials to add anti-Bolshevism against the Bolshevism. And I think this is an area that might be very worthwhile further study. And of course, the Odessa is one region where they were able to get Liebegrant himself, Rosenberg's deputy, was most intent on their getting everything they could from Odessa. And it was only later that part of it came back from the special collection.
Okay.
So, I have more to say.
Right. Sure. Thanks. Okay. Maybe we'll stop for now here. We'll ask our speakers.
One. Footnote. What is the exact language in Russian that is being translated as straightened out?
Bring the Russian edition. I didn't bring the Russian. I didn't bring the Russian edition, so I don't remember. It's very easy to find, of course, because there is a Russian edition. What does it mean to straighten out? Yes, Stalin says we must, remove Kosiol from the Ukraine and replace him with you, while keeping you as a secretary of the CC of the VKP. Then he goes on right after this transfer Balitsky to Ukraine on the post of chairman of Ukrainian GPU, remove Riedens, I think. And they are replaced with Chubala, and it's sort of reshuffling the card race. And as far as losing Ukraine, it seems to me clear. Well, I don't know whether it was realistic, but Poland will come, I think. But, you know, he was trying to, this is August, so I think no aggression treaty was signed in July, I think. But then the ratification didn't come until November or December. And Karl Radek, whom Stalin described as a man who is being managed by his tongue, goes to Poland and have discussions with the Polish authorities. And he says too much because his tongue doesn't stop. Where he says, we never thought that Poland would ratify the non-aggression pact. Poland was more interested in Germany. He was just trying to use these things to trick us, all these things. So when it was indeed signed, Radek was very pleased, and Radek changed his mind, and he thought, now Poland is so serious. And then it turned out that Poland signed the non-aggression treaty with Germany in early 1934, which made Radek's position very difficult. In the end, he was terrorized. I think he was beaten to death in 1937 or so. But it's not clear whether Stalin indeed thought that Poland would take it. There was a real danger that Poland might come in 1930 at the time when Ukraine was very weakened by collectivization and de-Krakization, but Poland didn't. And I'm not sure whether Stalin understood that Poland would indeed come in 1930-33, but he used the specter of Poland to strengthen Ukraine.
Thank you for your interesting question, but I think this is a very interesting subject for future research. As far as I know, we have a lot of evidence of intentional destruction by the Soviets of some specific types of the records. For example, great mass of health care ministry records in Ukraine, about 12,000 files were destroyed before the German invasion. Also party archives in Dnipropetrovsk, in Kiev. Probably at the same time, or even earlier, the direct instructions on destruction, the Zax books were also eliminated from the central archive of the Central Statistic Board in Kiev. As for the Zax books from the period of 1932-33, I am not sure that they were interesting for Germans, and I don't think they were dangerous for Soviets. Zax books, they were destroyed probably earlier. I don't think it happened before German invasion. I don't know.
Thank you.
Oh, we know that the Kiev Zax archive was destroyed, and we have German.
But not for the years of 1932-33.
Well, I don't know what we don't know
what
the details specific. Of what years were in the had been. Deposited in the archive before it was destroyed, and they at the time. But as I say, the flip side of the question is also important: is to what the Germans did. Why didn't the Germans raise the question of famine? They took all the pictures from the Kiev Central Photo Archives. They took a lot of these materials and wanted every bit of ammunition that they could find, anti-Bolshevik ammunition. And I'm just curious if someone doesn't want to look at some of their exhibits, some of the Nazi exhibits in Ukraine, and things, if there isn't some place that perhaps that they used the famine. This museum of the resistance in Kiev that they set up.
By Oglobling.
Yes. These types of things, and I think it's something that needs someone with good German and that couldn't check the German sources that exist from the war to see whether the Germans were using the famine. And this would be perfect ammunition for them, just the way they were using the destruction of churches and the destruction of this and that. Against the Soviets, it's just a point. I think that there could be more research, more
can
discussion
on this. Can I just comment on that? As far as Zax data are concerned, I think the raw data were not taken to Moscow, but some aggregate data were taken to Moscow. So even if raw data were lost, we may have a relatively reliable sort of, you know, general data about population deaths from famine or diseases. I think Moscow had some data. These are still there, I think, in Moscow, you know, Tsugaye, I think. So yes, it's important. We would like to have data, raw data, but the loss of raw data may not mean a total a loss. Of data. As far as German sources are concerned, yes, there are documents. There was a German consul in Kiev, for example, I quoted him. He has a sort of interesting memoirs about his work in Kiev as German consul. And of course, the Germans knew it. Hitler comes to power, and they took advantage of it and tried to sort of flare up the problems, and Russia, the Soviets were very concerned. And then Ruslan and other church organizations were trying to contact their own people in Ukraine, trying to send money to Ukrainians, Ukrainian Germans, and the Soviet authorities are extremely concerned. Poles did the same. They wanted to send their money to Ukrainian Poles. And yeah, the Soviets watched all these people who came to the consulate. So Nazi Germany did use that in 1933. After that, 1941, 42, I'm not sure. No, I don't see much. But they certainly knew it. They tried to use it, 1933.
Oh, okay. Dr. Plokhii, I was curious, why do you think still, currently, the New York Times does not publish any articles about Holodomor? And last week, when we had a 10-block-long procession, bringing attention to Holodomor, their one sentence about this was that it was a Ukrainian Day parade. And Dr. Flyer, I was curious, when Holodomor, the word, was first used, and when did it become commonly used?
Well, I know nothing about the New York Times editorial policy. Each day when I read the New York Times, I often get disgusted because for different reasons, for treatment of Iraq and other things. So I cannot speak for the New York Times. I simply don't know. I mean, they certainly considered stripping, not the New York Times, the prize committee? Pulitzer, yes, they considered it. They decided not, because they would have looked like the Soviets, giving prize, depriving prize, all these things. So why the New York Times doesn't, I simply don't know. Academics? Well, I don't have any position, really. It's their problem. There are cases like Nobel Prizes. Someone got Nobel Prize. It turned out later that finding the invention wasn't really worth anything. But I don't think they deprive them of prizes. So I'm not sure. I never really thought about it. I do think that Durant was completely wrong. New York Times probably knew it. Why they don't do it, it's their problem. A personal position, well, I haven't thought about it. Probably I should think about it. I think Mark von Hagen, for example, proposed. He was consulted by the New York Times, and I think he proposed that Durant be deprived of the Pulitzer Prize. The New York Times decided not to do it. Whether it was right or not, I can take two positions, yeah. But it's not really academic to me, so I'm maybe sort of trying to avoid the problems, but maybe the courts to say
something. Okay, thanks.
The reason why I brought up the whole issue of the distinction between the words Holod and Holodomor in my opening remarks yesterday was precisely because Holodomor already contains within it the sense of intentionality that Holod does not. My other point was that we actually do not know who first coined the word, and we do not know exactly when it was first used. So, and where. We don't know whether it started in Ukraine or among the diaspora, and we don't know whether where it was written.
Well, did you read like Ukrainian articles back then? Were they using Holodomor in the
30s? That all has to be investigated. Yeah, I think the answer is not so obvious. And my hunch is that it is rather late term rather than an earlier one. When I was talking with Leonid Heretz yesterday, he also mentioned that even the word Holod is not the normal way of talking about the famine when it was occurring. So I think this is an interesting question that needs a lot of good work.
Okay, thank you. Any other questions?
I just have a couple of comments to the last couple of questions or so. I think that the study of the famine has reached the point, and actually the symposium was supposed to be a step in that direction, that we can expand what it is that we are studying. I don't think it has to be any more limited to the actual events and the understanding of what occurred in 32, 33. That, of course, is the crux of the problem and the central issue. But now we can study the historiography, how the famine was treated in historical works. We can have special studies of sources. And actually, one of the interesting aspects is what you just alluded to, and that is the reception of the famine, the understanding of the famine in the media or in the, you know, the popular views of the famine. Durante was mentioned, you know, the Times not covering the march today was not mentioned. There was the very interesting example of the film Harvest of Despair, in contrast to the book Harvest of Sorrow, the story of how PBS refused to put it on the air. And then finally, it was put on the air on PBS, but not as a PBS product, but as part of a program of William Buckley with Robert Conquest as a commentator. There are publications such as in The Village Voice, which is widely read, which commenting on Conquest's book said, point out, the famine is a fraud being perpetrated by people like Conquest. There was a book on the famine as a fraud, quote, from Hitler to Harvard. There's an actual book. So I think that this is a matter of some interest for some researchers in the future, and I think that should be pursued. I have a follow-up question to Pat, and it's probably directed both to Mr. Boriak and Mr. Podkur. It occurred to me that a portion of the territory suffering from the famine was at least briefly under the occupation of Romania. And I'm wondering whether, because the question was about what the Germans did, I wonder whether there was, you know, anything that the Romanians may have done or taken away or whatever. I'm just curious. Or has anyone looked into that problem?
Okay. If I may, because we are running out of time, kind of, I thought if there are any other questions, again, maybe we can have them asked at this time, and then our speakers will answer to that. If not, then we can consider that to be the final question of this session. Okay? So I wonder if anyone would like to answer this question.
Romania.
On Romania.
Romania.
Я думаю, що зараз давайте.
Maybe I'll try to interpret what Professor Podkor is going to say.
Справа в тому, що дійсно голод був і на території частково на території, яка прилягала до радянської України і на території Румунії. Справа в тому, що в окупаційних документах, які знаходяться в Державному архіві Вінницької області, румунські окупаційні війська серйозним чином використовували голод 1932-33 в пропаганді ідей, в пропаганді, в антибільшовицькій пропаганді, в першу чергу.
Yes, indeed, famine affected the areas of Ukraine that bordered on Romania, and also there was famine on the territory of Romania per se. During the World War II occupation, the Romanian occupation authorities, they used facts related to the famine of 1932-33 in their anti-Soviet propaganda.
Населення на території окупованій Румунією серйозним чином засуджувала сталінський режим за цей голод. Вона активно приймала участь в тій, ну як в румунській пропаганді, в антибільшовицькій пропаганді. Вони вважали це геноцидом проти румунської нації, проти української нації. І це фактично серйозним чином підтверджується документом.
Well, the population, Ukrainian population on the Romanian occupied territories, they were quite receptive to Romanian official propaganda, and they condemned the famine. They considered it also to be part of the genocide against Ukrainian nation, and basically facilitated activities of the Romanian propaganda in that regard.
Це підтверджується заявами, численними заявами українців до румунських органів, окупаційних органів. Вони так і писали: «Я як постраждав від політичних репресій та голоду, і прошу надати мені допомогу там про щось». Це була формула, яка дуже часто зустрічається в заявах до румунської окупаційної влади.
Well, and Ukrainian survivors of famine, they used quite often references to famine in the official documentation that they would send to the Romanian occupational authorities, saying that I suffered from the, I was the victim of political repressions and famine, and on this basis I am asking from the authorities for this or that favor or whatever they were asking for.
Okay. I would like just to add a few words to what my colleague said. There are a lot of posters and leaflets that circulated on the territory of Odessa and Vinnytsia Oblast in the territory of Transnistria, which were prepared and printed by Romanian and Nazi administrations, in which famine is used as the subject of anti-Bolshevik propaganda. So some of them are published on our web site in the section Ukraine between two totalitarian regimes, I mean occupation. So one can view them.
I see that there is one more person want to ask the question, so that will be the final question.
The criticism is levied against scholarship which tries to prove that the famine was a deliberate attempt at murdering a nation of Ukrainian farmers. Is there a comparative study which can demonstrate that people in other Soviet republics who were dying at this time, 32-33, were not deliberately being massacred as opposed to Ukraine?
I haven't looked at Kazakhstan very much, but I think they're doing. I mean, at least some of them. Some of them think that it's, yeah, of course, it's ethnic, if not genocide, certainly serious attack against against the Kazakhs, just as the Irish people. Just as the Irish people think, or many of them think, that the Irish potato famine was a deliberate killing of Irish by the British, I mean by the English.
Okay, thank you very much for your questions. I would like to thank once again our speakers for really very interesting and stimulating presentations and for the answers to your question. So we're having a break now, and we're continuing with our program at 2 p.m., if I'm not mistaken. So see you at 2.
Please. So ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the third and final session of our symposium. It's entitled The Famine as a Historical Phenomenon, Directions of Future Research. This is prepared and conceived as a round table, so you have to sort of imagine us in a circular rather than a linear form here. but what I have proposed to my colleagues is that everyone will speak for about 7-8 minutes maximum, and some maybe even shorter, especially those who have already had a chance to speak. And then I'll just say a few words on my own behalf, and then we'll ask again everybody to comment on what they have just heard and their thoughts, having heard their colleagues and whatever transpired in these last two sessions. And then we'll open up the floor for discussion. Hopefully we can, even though we have a large panel here with six panelists, we can keep to our schedule. The first speaker will be Professor Roman Szporluk. Or do you want to speak in that fashion?
Well, I can, but I thought it was last, but it's all right.
Yeah. Oh, I see, because I thought you had asked to you know, people, I'm sorry, I take it back. We'll do the order that we have here. It's just that you were sitting at the end, so I was somehow thinking we're doing it. And no, we'll take the order that we have here, but people can either speak from their chairs or from the podium if it's more comfortable for you. So Hennadii Boriak, is he around? Please, Hennadii, do join us too. I don't think Dr. Boriak requires an introduction. We've had that. We are, in a sense, continuing the proceeding. Please.
I'd like to speak from the chair, probably. So I will try to summarize some of my speculations based primarily on the archives and sources of the famine genocide. I would like to suggest some directions or possible projects dealing with archives. First, to my mind, very important one is the digitization of all records of vital registry books. I talked about this earlier. There are about 3 million death records in these books survived. And I think we have to put all of them into the database with full text publication. Another project, probably maybe a publication, both electronically and in a traditional book format, the complete set of photo documents of the famine. In addition to this, in addition to the famine genocide, I suppose it's very important to publish all photos which are not authentic for the famine of 1932-33. That is photos from other famines, mainly from 1921-22, and also from other territories of the Soviet Russia. I think it's very important we have not heard about this mapping of the famine genocide. It's quite possible to put on a map many data from the sources available. I mean all villages from the blacklist. Many other events that may be formalized and put on the map. in addition to the map of Ukraine, we may compile a map of other territories in on which famine raged. I mean, Kuban, Ural, and Volga region. And one of the main components of such maps should be ethnic data. So these are my suggestions shortly. Thank you.
Good. Thank you, Hennadii. No, it's okay. You can keep this. Our next speaker, the person who is instrumental in organizing this symposium and who opened it yesterday, Dr. Lubomyr Hajda.
Well, thank you. I think I've had a chance to express some of my ideas already in my various introductions and comments and questions. Let me just make two or three points. I think that the famine has now become a subject of, how to put it, perhaps using the jargon of Ukrainian politics today, of multi-vectoral studies rather than, you know, unidirectional. I think there is need of a new synthesizing work that can be a kind of an analog to the conquest book of 25 years ago, but incorporating the newest findings from the sources and intervening studies. That is something that other people can address better than I. There is the idea expressed at our last symposium, which was 5 years ago on the occasion of the 70th anniversary by Professor Andrea Graziosi, that it is time to look beyond the immediate consequences of the famine and look at the long, medium and long range consequences, some of which persist to this very day. His remarks were published originally in their abbreviated form in Harvard Ukraine Studies. I can't remember the issue number. Halina will be able to tell us. And a more expanded version of his ideas is going to be published shortly. But these ideas have become the basis for our ongoing discussion among some of us for the conference that will be held a year from now that Professor Flyer mentioned in his opening remarks yesterday. And then I think that there is now the possibility of moving into a number of areas that are even fairly new for Ukrainian studies, or indeed, you know, for scholarship in general. For example, the notion of the study of memory. And, you know, here there may be, shall we say, two sides of the coin. One is the attempt by the regime to eradicate or obliterate the memory of the famine. And on the other hand, the maintenance, the persistence, the revival, and, you know, drawing into this the methodologies, the experience of people who have studied memory, because there are obviously all kinds of inherent problems, some of which Professor Heretz mentioned when he was talking about eyewitness accounts. That is another area, I think, that we should perhaps go into. And then the source basis, I think, is sufficient, and I think especially the eyewitness accounts can provide some basis for, again, probing into other newer areas. For example, scholars interested in women's studies can perhaps look at the fate of women during the famine. There undoubtedly were specificities that were gender-related, questions dealing with motherhood, with physical stamina, and so forth and so on. These are just a couple of examples where my thoughts have been going, where we can expand without necessarily just, you know, retreading the same, you know, problems of statistics and the numbers of victims and, you know, do we go up by 100,000 or down by 100,000, which I think is less productive.
Good. Thank you very much. Our next commentator is Professor Leonid Heretz, please.
Thank you. Start with the general observation and then a specific suggestion or idea. My general observation is that the famine and the tragedy of the millions of people who died in it and the millions who survived has been cursed by politics. It originated in politics, knowledge was suppressed by politics, then it was associated with Nazi propaganda, then it was associated with Cold War propaganda. So this topic has been, I believe, very thoroughly infected with politics. And in Ukraine today, unfortunately, it's become a bit of a party issue of a divided society, and this is an orange issue. And currently, the administration of the president is trying to build up the kind of national myth, national identity on it. And there's nothing we can do about his policies or the results of them. I would just hope that scholarship as much as possible would be free of the political spirit. With regard to concrete suggestion, as I mentioned earlier, there's a great wealth now of eyewitness accounts. The problem is they're in such a format that they're not readily readily available. Either they're scattered around the newspapers or else they're in these massive collections that no one can possibly read. I think it would be very worthwhile to create some representative anthology and have that possibly in English as well. And it might also be worthwhile if such a thing were to be translated into Russian, because for better or for worse, a large portion of the population of Ukraine prefers not to read Ukrainian books. So that's what I have to say.
Thank you. Hiroaki,
yes. I've spoken so much here that I don't seem to have much else to say, but I think if I have any proposal, then it will be this. I think from, I'm not really an insider in the sense that I have no connection to the Ukrainian community. I'm just an interested scholar. So I know the both sides very well. It reminds me of what Dr. Senkus, I'm not sure where the accent is, mentioned a couple of years ago at the WWF session on the famine, that Ukrainian community tends to ignore commentaries or criticism from our side. If we exclude, of course we have agreements, of course we have different opinions, we should respect each other. But sometimes it's important to have a serious dialogue with those who question our views. Our views means it's the Ukrainian community's views, Ukrainian specialist views, somehow. Now it's a good opportunity, it's a good time because the Cold War was gone. Many archival documents became available. We can interpret many things based on the documents, eyewitness accounts. There are so many more based on which we can have normal, dispassionate, sober argument. I don't know whether this is practical or not, because still there is a lot of passion involved in this matter. Why? Well, for the Ukrainian community, of course, reason is very clear. For the other side, I'm not sure. But I think if we could have some serious argument, then perhaps we can find ways to bridge what appears to be a very wide gap. Maybe that's all I wanted to say.
Well, we're moving much more efficaciously than I expected. So this is all to the good. We'll have much more time for a discussion. Our next speaker is Professor Serhii Plokhii.
Well, thanks, George. For me, the discussions that we had in the last 2 days were a real revelation. Also, I believe they provided a really good platform from which we can look back where the famine project started here at Harvard, and assess the amount of scholarship, the research that was done since then in the last quarter of a century, 25 years, and also to think about where we are going. Well, one of the needs that became quite obvious for me, actually, I thought about that before, but especially after this panels yesterday and today, is that there is certainly a need for a new synthesis, something that Dr. Hajda mentioned before. Book by Robert Conquest, extremely influential book. It remains to be the standard book in the field when the field in itself moved ahead. And there is no other books produced in the last 25 years that would actually perform this function. Archives were opened, new research was done, new questions asked, new debates conducted, and there is certainly a need to assess all of that, to present a story of this one of the biggest tragedies in history of Ukraine, but also in history of Eastern Europe in general, in the 20th century. I think that conferences like that, and more importantly, more sustained effort, supported by academic institutions, supported by the community, can certainly help achieve that goal. There is a number of ways in which we can and we can should reevaluate, reassess our knowledge and also to shape our new understanding of the phenomenon of the Great Famine. And I completely agree with ideas, at least most of the ideas that were expressed by and presented by my colleagues here.
Thank you. Sorry, Roman, for delaying so long. It's your turn.
I cannot talk and hold a microphone at the same time, so I will speak from here, if I may. This works. It will momentarily.
I appreciate the an opportunity to participate in this conference, although I am myself not a researcher, a scholar of the Holodomor, and I have learned a lot at this conference, and I appreciate that opportunity, but I will allow myself to express some thoughts on this from the point of view of someone who is trying, has been trying perhaps too long, to write a history of Ukraine and now claims to have written it and now is rewriting it. And to offer you some remarks about how I propose, and it's not a recommendation to anyone how they should organize their conferences, simply how one might treat Holodomor within the frame of what I think, as I conceive, history of Ukraine. And it seems to me that one of the things which we need to think is to place the Holodomor in the frame of history of Ukraine as history of Ukraine and Ukrainians. And the other dimension is in the context of European and world history of the 20th century. In connection with the first part, namely, context of Ukrainian history, I would point out first of all, I already mentioned it in conversations, that the famine is in time closer to the abolition of serfdom in 1861 than it is to us. We are 75 years away from the famine and count from 1861 to 1933 the time frame. In other words, a historian of Ukraine connects the history of the 19th century with the history of the 20th century. And the historian sees that the Ukrainian peasants count how long were they free, if you count that they really were free after 1861, and how free they were already between 1917 and 33. You have a dramatic example. If you put it in this frame, what kind of people they were who were being starved to death. I think it is important. I could give you other examples because I'm working on an article on this subject. Ems Ukaz is closer to 33 than it is to us. You can count more events of that kind. I like to mention that Professor Hrushevsky was born just 70 years after the death of Catherine II, which gives you an idea about the frame in which he lived and in which he functioned. I will spare you more examples of that kind, but then perhaps I should mention that the Decembrist uprising is closer to 1918. The revolution of 1848 is closer to 1918 than it is to us. So Holodomor is a history for us which we cannot understand unless we connect it to the events which preceded it. It might be worth mentioning that after all, the map of Ukraine, we think that map of Ukraine, all textbooks have that map of Ukraine, Ukraine in the age of Neanderthals, and you have the current map of Ukraine, the age of the Paleolite Ukraine, but the map of Ukraine was being formed at the time we are talking about. In 1917, there was a big debate between the provisional government and people in Kyiv, what is Ukraine? Provisional government was willing to reorganize Ukraine in the borders of the Hetmanate. That was the last Ukraine they knew. And Hrushevsky said, no, 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 we have another map of Ukraine. In our minds, there is a map of Ukraine of 1897, based on the census. So what I am trying to suggest, as I look at it, is we are dealing with a period of a great confusion about the map, about time frames, and if you remember again what I said about the peasants, these people are barely, they are still remember the serfdom. Some, if their grandparents are alive, not many are alive, they still remember Kripachina. So that's the time. Now there has been a lot and lot of talk here, and people are writing Stalin, Stalin, what Stalin knew, what Stalin meant. Maybe I will offer you a comment how I treat it. In 1933, Stalin was closer to the Polish-Soviet War of 1920 than we are now to 1991. For Stalin, the October Revolution in 1933 was exactly the length of the event which we call Ukrainian independence, of which today we are commemorating the referendum. 16 years, 1917-1933, 16 years, 1991, today. In other words, for Stalin, the war of 1920, we cannot understand now, why on earth did Stalin worry so much about the Poles? Well, very simple, because in 1920, the Poles were in Kyiv. And there was Polish intelligence service, as he thought, and underground, and there were Petlurites. That was his frame. And in order to understand, therefore, his behavior, this is the frame which we have to bear in mind. Quickly, because my time is running out, some comments about the frame of Ukrainian Holodomor in international history. And I connect with Stalin too. World War I began in 1914. It was less than 20 years away. And as we know, this was an unbelievable Holocaust. Millions of people were killing other people because some of them were German and others were French. People were killing them because when you remember what Bolsheviks were talking about when people said you are shooting people left and right because they wear glasses or because they have beards or because they are professors. the Bolsheviks were saying, but didn't you guys shoot people just because they were Germans or because Frenchmen? In other words, think about the Great World War as an event which shows you that killing millions of people under certain circumstances can be legitimate. We may disagree with Stalin's choice of victims, but you have to admit that there were some examples of how you can kill millions of people in the name of good causes. So that is one, I think, example. Now, there were more stories of that kind, and I would say that we need to think, therefore, of the 20th century, and here I would like to mention Andrea Graziosi, who has written this very influential book on the world and revolution in 20th century. Now a new version has come out. We are dealing with a very peculiar 20th century, which, as Isaiah Berlin wrote in one of his essays, is unique in world history because it is a century in which people discriminated against other people in the past. But people never thought that you can solve the problem by just killing people off. Anti-Semitism was known long before 1900, but only in the 20th century, people who disliked the Jews thought we can get rid of them by just killing them off. So the idea of solving a problem by killing off the bourgeoisie, killing off the kulaks, killing off Ukrainians or Armenians, was part of the 20th century history. And here, I think, again, we need to bear that in mind if we want to understand the setting. Okay, I think my time is definitely up, so I will still allow myself one more point to return to what I was saying earlier, precisely to understand Poland as a big threat. You have to remember, as I say, those immediate events, but then you can also remember that the Soviets were killing off people called Poles during the purges, during the famine, and during the purges, because for them still, 1863 was not really that very distant history. So to sum up, I would suggest that we think of the Holodomor, we set it in the setting of Ukrainian history, flow of time, and related, as I say, to Shevchenko and 61 and so on, and also a part of world history. And one final comment, we are dealing here now, this is not just archival research. It is archival research, but it is now the famine, the Holodomor, is an event which is now a crucial component of the formation of modern Ukrainian national identity. For Ukrainians to be a free nation, they have to know their history. And if you want to bring in this story, now why Russians are not interested in their problems, and they had horrible stories too in their history. After all, the bourgeoisie was being killed off, and Ukrainian patriots then did not terribly protest when Russian bourgeoisie was being killed off, before the Ukrainian kulaks were being killed off. Numbers were different, but the experience was the same. I would say the Russians have now the same problem, that they seem not to want to know their past. And if Ukraine is going to be a democracy, it will have to do what Boriak is doing and his colleagues. If Russia is to be democracy, they have to do the same thing. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I also would like to make a few comments, but rather than speak from the podium, could I have this mic attached here? No, but I mean so as not to hold in my hand, because I need to refer to a book. So could we push that thing forward here?
Actually, I have a table stand I can give you.
Yeah, that's good.
Oh, good. That's excellent. Thank you. Taking the privilege of the chair here to also address some topics, I would like to continue on in the vein that Professor Szporluk just did by placing the Holodomor in the context of Ukrainian history by addressing an issue that is in the back of the minds of everyone here, that has been obliquely or even almost directly alluded to by some of the speakers, but which we, as we were planning this symposium, were implicitly or tacitly deferring for a later session for our fall 2008 discussion. But I think that it really has to be addressed here because it is essential to the very notion that we're talking about, and that is to say the whole notion of genocide and of genocide studies. One of the things that was rather missing in our symposium so far is a comparative approach. And I think that that is, for a scholarly and academic exercise, that is by itself an important component, but it is especially important when the issue that we are addressing is precisely of whether, and if so, how, the Holodomor was a genocide. I think for me personally, and for many of us here, that issue has already been decided in the positive. And the very way that Dr. Boriak was translating the term Holodomor was precisely as famine genocide, with a hyphen, which I think is a perfectly adequate translation of the term. But I think this is something that even while we defer it for a broad and indeed comparative discussion at a future date, which we clearly are intending, let me just point to a few moments that pertain here. One is that this is still an ongoing issue for some people. As recently as 2 weeks ago at the AAASS convention in New Orleans, there was a paper that was entitled, "Was the Ukrainian Famine a Genocide?" by Mr. Elman. Yes, our colleague from Amsterdam. He put it in a rather cautious way, certainly not denying it, but also not accepting it. And the way he did it is with an analogy to the interpretations of the Constitution. Do we use a strict or a loose interpretation? If it is a strict interpretation, it is not. If it is a loose interpretation, i.e. more encompassing, more liberal, then it is. And the sticking point, of course, is A, the kind of crime that qualifies for it, that is to say, the kind of people who are killed, do they qualify for it if they are a social group rather than an ethnic or a religious group? Because this is according to the United Nations Convention of 1948. And B, the actual nature of intentionality, of the actual intention behind the acts. And what I want to bring to you in just a few quotes, because there is a very fine study that on which I'm drawing here, this issue, in a sense, has already been decided. In a sense, from the scholarly, from the sociological, rather than from the if you will, legal and definitionalist, as the term has it, approach, you know, where there's a certain kind of almost compulsion to have the exact definition as it is in law and so on, the issue has been decided. Let me give you one example. In this study that appeared in 1994, it's called Genocide, Conceptual and Historical Dimensions, the focus is on a number of genocides, beginning maybe as early as the Armenian genocide of 1915 and going all the way to events in Indonesia and, well, not Darfur, because that is even more recent. So you see that a very broad broad range. The issue that is posed, the approach that is taken most cogently, most impressively by a man called Israel Charny, who is the executive director of the Jerusalem-based Institute for Genocide and Holocaust Studies. For him, and I would like to give a quote from him that I think is extremely telling. He says that all of these phenomena need to be identified as genocides, and any hierarchy of more in the definition and more out of the definition are not only not historically and, if you will, sociologically correct, but are in some sense morally suspect. This is his quote. He says the definition of genocide must also be consistent with the everyday usage of the word by reasonable people when they stand and face a mass of murdered people and naturally apply to such an event the only word there is in the human language for such occurrences. Let me just make a digression here. The language of the United Nations Charter, drawing on Raphael Lemkin's original use of the word genocide, was specifically conditioned or adjusted to the desires both of the Soviet Union and Great Britain, which was then supporting it, to exclude the category of political and social victims. They say those were not included. Only ethnic, religious victims were included. So to continue with Charny, he says, thus the mass murder of 20 million Soviet citizens by Stalin, the massacre of 100,000 or more of the communist opposition by Indonesia, the murders of 1 to 2 million Cambodians by the Khmer Rouge are all instances of clear-cut genocide. And instances, and this is where he extends it even further. I think, morally speaking, there's great reason here. There's great persuasiveness there. But at the same time, indeed, a further argument opens up, which I'll bring in as soon as I finish with the quote. And the instances, to return to him, of mass murder of a lesser magnitude by governments, and the essential moment here, of course, is precisely that it is governments, that it is states that are doing this. 5,000 Tamils in Sri Lanka and 5,000 students in Tiananmen Square in China, for example, are also, in common sense and understanding, genocidal events. Although there may be a consensus to characterize these numerically smaller events as genocidal massacres, as Leo Cooper, the doyen of genocide scholars, has proposed. I think all of this is extremely important. This contextualization, in a sense, removes an issue which we heard today, for example, of how certain the evidence must be, whether there is a smoking gun. As is clear from the studies included in this volume, and I would like to give you more quotes, but this can be deferred for some other occasion, it is precisely the nature of genocidal states to hide the evidence, to conceal the evidence, to hide the tracks, to cover up. This was discussed today. And at the same time, the massiveness of the crime is such that it cannot be hidden. So in a sense, there is a historical inevitability in us coming to the evidence that was presented in the archives and so on. To conclude, because I certainly don't want to speak more, so as we can put this into the range of discussion that will now follow. I think that we need to look also at the question of, if you will, genocidal societies, or in this case, of a genocidal state. And that is, of course, Stalin's Soviet Union. Whether the Soviet Union was genocidal after 1953 is certainly much more debatable. More likely not, but still, millions were still perishing in the gulag, or at least languishing in the gulag. And in the initial definition, by the way, this kind of human persecution is also considered a crime against humanity, not just the extermination of people, but this kind of persecution of people. But certainly until the death of Stalin, the Soviet Union was a genocidal state. And not only the Ukrainian famine, but the mass terror, the Katyn events, all of these things point to it. And this was already developed here, or at least alluded to. Another moment that we need to study further is the whole phenomenon of denial of this. Just as there is Holocaust denial, there is Holodomor denial, and it's, while much less now than before, the references of these egregious examples were already alluded to by Dr. Hajda, this is still somewhat ongoing, but I think the momentum is on our side, and I think that there is still much to be done, but the truth and the matter is coming out. Thank you. Well,